Then we have understood what was the situation of IT infrastructure before cloud, and then we understood why, you know, about the cloud computing, what is cloud computing and what are the models in the cloud computing, the deployment models, the service models. Okay, and we understood, you know, the characteristics of the cloud computing. When is a service called as a cloud computing? When we understood the benefits of cloud computing, and we, you know, understood the, as I said earlier, you know, the deployment and the service models. We understood what is public cloud, private cloud, and the, you know, hybrid cloud. We also, you know, understood the service models, which are the infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. And we also understood what, you know, we as a customer will manage when we take a service on the cloud, and what the service provider will manage. Then we understood between, you know, the difference between the capital expenditure as well as the, you know, operational expenditure. And, you know, we understood what are the various infrastructure service and platform service and software service provider. And we have briefly gone understood what is Azure, and we did a tour of Azure services. And, you know, we understood the core infrastructure components of Microsoft Azure, the regions, the geographies, the availability sets, availability zones. So this infrastructure understanding will not be clear as of now, but when we create a virtual machine, when we do virtual machine scale set, you will definitely understand what is an availability zone, what is a region, everything will be very clear. So just have patience for, you know, one more week, you know, you will clearly understand. We also understood the different region as of now, what is Microsoft is having. And we also understood the regional pairs. What is a regional pair? We took the example of, you know, West India and South India can be a region pair. Central India and South India can be a region pair for our disaster recovery. Okay. So now we are going to start with our today's topic. This would be identity and access management within Microsoft Cloud. So this technology, this service of Microsoft is common across the Microsoft Cloud offerings, whether it's Microsoft Azure or Office 365 or Microsoft 365 or Dynamics 365. So these users management and identity management across, you know, across all the cloud services of Microsoft. So before we understand, you know, what is, you know, Active Directory, we will just understand certain terminologies, you know, before we move it for a clear understanding. So you guys already have a Microsoft account, right? You have the Outlook account, you have your Office and Work account, which you have already created using, you know, from Office 365 or, you know, any other Microsoft service if you already have within your organization, or you have any Microsoft account. So that is called an account. So that account is actually an identity, and this is used for, you know, logging into Azure, as well as, you know, the first account which we create, you know, when we purchase an Azure subscription, that will become the global administrator as well as the billing account, you know, on which Microsoft will bill us. Okay. I hope everyone is able to hear me clearly, right?
Yes.
Great.
So yes.
Next is Azure subscription. So as I said, anything, this is very important to understand, you know, please pay attention on this. So Azure subscription is the logical container, you know, where you provision the resources on Microsoft Azure. Okay. It holds all the details about your resources. Without subscription, you will not be able to do anything on the Azure front. So you need to have an Azure account, Azure subscription. Even though you had a, you know, Office 365 account or, you know, Microsoft account, you will be able to log into portal.azure.com, but you will not be able to do anything until unless you have a subscription. So there are various subscriptions which you can take from Microsoft. One such subscription is the free trial, which we are going to use, you know, soon. The other is pay as you go. After, you know, you convert, you know, after you upgrade your free account to, you know, upgrade your free account, it will become a pay as you go subscription, where you will be paying, you know, for whatever you use. on that subscription. Other is enterprise subscription, enterprise agreement subscription. So let's say you are a big enterprise, you know, Microsoft has a relationship with a lot of enterprise. I know you can go and, you know, buy a subscription from Microsoft, from a partner. Another subscription which I have not mentioned, other is a student subscription. If you are a student and your organization is enrolled, your education is enrolled with Microsoft, then you can have a student subscription as well. You can also have another two subscriptions are there, which is one is called CSV subscription. Microsoft has partners, right? They are also able to, you know, give you subscription as their customers. That is called CSP subscription. So cloud solution provider subscription. And other is MPN. If you are a software developer, there are like Visual Studios, right? Visual Studio. If you buy Visual Studio, Microsoft gives you certain credits every month on Visual Studio. You can have that subscription as well. But for this class, we will be using a free trial account. And from there, we will be going ahead. You as a, you know, person can have multiple subscriptions, okay? This is the Azure account, and I have, you know, in this diagram, I have three subscriptions. So I can have more than one subscription. I can have one enterprise agreement subscription, one CSP subscription, one pay-as-you-go subscription, one free trial. I can have multiple subscription. I can be owner of multiple subscription. A single person, single user, single account can be owner of multiple subscription. And billing happens on the subscription level. Okay. Every subscription will have its separate billing. So as I said, let me move this. So as I said, subscriptions in Azure are both a billing entity as well as security boundary. So anything within the subscription is, you know, secure in that boundary itself. So every resources are, you know, associated with a single subscription. You cannot have a single resource in multiple subscription, right? Single resource will be in a single subscription. And each the subscription will have a single account owner. But an account owner can have multiple subscriptions, okay? And the subscription is associated with the Active Directory, okay? Even if you have, you know, once you have the ID role, you have to have the RBAC role to have the subscription. We'll understand that, you know, in later stage. So Azure Active Directory is, you know, the Microsoft cloud-based identity and access management service. So this is all cloud-based. You did not, you know, install any software or do anything, you know, to set up it. It's already set up. You just have to go and create the users and uses. As I informed earlier, it acts as a single sign-on. You just give one ID to your user and they can log into any of these Microsoft resources and other of thousands apps. Microsoft has integrated many third-party apps. You can also do, you know, give authentication and authorization using Azure AD for those apps. Please note, Azure AD is not the cloud version of Windows Server AD. If someone is from your Windows Server background, they will understand, you know, we have Windows Server AD also. This is not the cloud version. This is different altogether. Okay. So how, you know, what happens, you know, you have three kinds of entities in Azure Active Directory. So one is a normal user, you know, he's an entity, and you have, you know, user groups, and you have a service principles. Service principles are nothing but the resources of Azure. Okay. You know, let's say application server speaks with a database server. So that is a service principle. If you are aware of AWS, we have roles there, right? So that is similar to a service principle here. So as I said, when an organization signs up for any Microsoft cloud offering, they are assigned with a default directory, which is nothing but your Azure. Yeah,
sorry to interrupt. Can you just expand a little bit on service principle?
Sure.
Because when you're talking about entities of Active Directory, we understand that we have... Oh, my voice is echoing, I guess.
Yeah, I can hear you.
So, yeah. So when you're talking about entities, we understand user and user groups.
Yes.
But, when you're talking about service principle, how can service be an entity? Like, how can, like, by the term of it, it seems a little confusing.
Yes. So there's a service called Identity Platform in Microsoft. Okay. With that, what you can do is, you know, you can register any of your on-premise or cloud-native apps within Azure, okay? and your all the authentication for those apps can happen using this service principle. So what Microsoft does, you know, they have certain tokens. They use technology like OpenID and OAuth 0.2. So with that, you can access, you know, you can generate access tokens, and with that access token, you can, you know, consume any of the Azure services. So let's say, for example, you have an application server, you have a database server, you have authentication, you know, happening for this database server, but you want that authentication to happen using certificates. Okay. So now your database. Guys, you know, if you're not speaking, you know, you can mute yourself. You can go, you know, you can give access, you can, you know, assign that service principle, you can register that database, and that database will access using access token. It will access the certificates from, you know, any other certificate provider.
Asif, we lost you. I can't hear you.
Am I clear now?
Yeah, you're audible now. Yeah, we couldn't hear you in between when you were talking.
Okay. Just give me 1 minute. Am I clear now?
Yeah. So you were saying about the service principle as service principle is just the service to establish the connection between the application and the database host.
I hope this is more clear.
Yeah, we can hear you
so
now.
Just hold on for a bit. You know, we will, you know, try to understand each user group, and when we go to app registration, we will understand the service principle also. So, you know, that will help you, that will give you more understanding. Just hold on for a minute.
Okay.
I know,
sure.
We'll go from there. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you.
So, yeah. So, you know, as I said, Azure Active Directory is the first thing what you get whenever you try to get a service from Microsoft. Okay. And all the users and groups, everything is, you know, accessed to e-services, you know, once you sign up. So default directory is referred as the tenant name. Okay, it's called a tenant. So directory is called as a tenant. So each given subscription is associated with a single Active Directory tenant. So there are three things which we have learned. One is, you know, whenever we sign up for a Microsoft Cloud offering, we would be getting an Active Directory, okay, default directory, which is nothing but Azure AD. And this Azure AD is not similar to Windows AD. Okay. And this default directory is called as tenant. So everything, any services within Microsoft comes under this tenant. So whether you are using Office 365, whether you are using Azure, whether you are using Dynamics 365, everything is under this default directory. And every subscription is associated with single directory only. A subscription cannot have multiple directory. Okay. So I just alliterated in the example. A user can be in multiple directories, but a subscription can only be in a single directory. In single directory, you can have multiple subscription, but this, you know, subscription one cannot be part of this directory, you know, directory two. So they can only be part of one Azure directory. A user can be part of multiple directories, same user. Okay. So, you know, these are the basic things. Identity in general is thing that can be authenticated, like person. Okay. And the account is the, you know, the data associated with that identity. Azure AD account is the identity created through Azure AD. We have Azure AD directory, that is nothing but the Azure tenant. Okay. And when we create this tenant, right, Microsoft gives us a default name, which will be like the company name .onmicrosoft.com. So this will be the default name what Microsoft gives to any customer whoever tries to purchase the services. So once we get the directory, we will go and verify our own domain name, which can be anything like psf.com. We'll verify that, and then we will create the users. So these are the differences between the Windows AD, you know, domain, Active Directory domain service, and Azure AD. Azure AD works on HTTP and HTTPS communication. Okay. And queried using REST API over HTTP and HTTP instead of LDAP. in Windows Active Directory, it is used the lightweight directory protocol, but here it is all through HTTPS. Okay. So Azure AD comes in different plans. Okay. The different plans gives you different features. We'll go to these plans different afterwards. Before that, you know, we will just have a look into Azure Active Directory first. So this is my directory. So when I signed up using my this email ID, right, asif.syed@it@outlook.com, I created an Azure subscription. So Microsoft created a directory for me. So this is my directory name, asif.syed@it@outlook. It took, you know, by default. So you can see the primary domain name here, right? So this is the tenant name which was given to me. So use as you can see, it ends with onmicrosoft.com. So every directory will end with this name. So they take the company's name and then the onmicrosoft.com, and this name will be unique. Now someone else cannot go and take this name because I have already taken. So this name is, you know, unique to me. No one else can take. But what I can do, I can verify a domain, custom domain name. This is the domain name I have. I can verify domain names. In Azure Active Directory, you can have up to 990 domains. So no, 990 domains can be verified. And when I create a user, I can create the user with the directory name, or I can create the user with the custom domain name which I have verified.
So can you define the domain name, like by the direct custom, by the you know, tenant name that we got, that is being displayed here? We understand that it took by default with the one that you registered.
Yes.
Right. But what do you mean by domain name? So like instead of using Asif Syed, we can use digital IT there, bulk one. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. So let's say, you know, it will not be good, you know, if we are communicating with people with your tenant name, right? And you want this to be, you know, as a secret of your organization. So what you do, and you have email address associated, right? Microsoft comes with Office 365 service also. So if I want to create a user, right? So I just, you know, go ahead. I will give the username as user 6. And I can create this with directory, or I can create it with my domain name. Now the user will be like this, user6@digitalintellect.in. So that is the reason you have, you know, this is for use, so that employees did not have multiple login credentials to use their emails and to use, you know, their Azure services. So they have a single directory. So initially, you know, when we start anything, the first thing we do is we verify the domain. Then only we'll create the users. And let's say if you want to integrate your on-prem Active Directory, so on-prem Active Directory will not recognize, names with on.microsoft.com. So you require, digitalintellect.in name only there, domain name.
Asif, sorry to interrupt you here. Actually, what I was thinking is, like, as you have mentioned, that whenever we go for the subscription, no matter whether it is the free one or
sorry,
the other
I'm unable
one,
to hear you. There's sort of static from me.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah. So I just missed out on this one, this part. When we take the subscription, the Microsoft Azure will all automatically provide us the directory, right?
Yes.
In that, we would start creating the domains.
Yeah, you will verify the domain first. So what you'll do, you'll go to first thing. What you'll do when you start, you know, as a fresh, you'll go to your Active Directory.
Okay.
Then you go to your domains. Okay. And you add a custom domain. So this domain, you have to use it. So I have this domain, Digital Intellect, right? So what I do, let's type some other name, psf.com, okay? So, you know, I said add domain. So it added, okay? Now it will give me, you know, few records, DNS records. It will ask me to go and verify this. So I have to go to my DNS register. In my case, I have, GoDaddy. I go to GoDaddy and, I just give this domain name. I just go and I verify this TXT. Once it is verified, I know I can see as verified here.
Okay.
So I'll just remove this. So it will say verified. So once it is verified, Now I will go to direct, you know, Azure again. Now I will create the users. This is the thing. But you can also create users. Let's say your requirement is you do not want to verify the domain. Your company does not want to verify. They are comfortable using the tenant name. Then you can create usernames with user one at, you know, your tenantname.com. You can create them. They can work. They can also send emails also. But this is, you know, depends on organization. But 99% organization, they verify the domain name because it's easy and that, you know, that's branding for their company, right?
Got your point.
Yeah, okay. They do that. Okay. And once, you know, by default, no access is given to a user. They are just users. Okay. Okay. Let's create a user. I know we created user 6. And we did not create, right?
So let's create active, a user.
Yeah.
Sorry user. To interrupt. No and problem. This Active Directory option would show up even for free accounts because I created a free account, but it's not showing up for me as your Active Directory.
No, it will show. It will definitely show. Even mine is a free account.
Okay, I shall navigate further.
You just, yeah, you have to learn the navigation.
I'm getting the Active Directory, but after that, there is an error for me, to be frank.
Okay. No, it should not be. There should not be an error if you have provision correctly.
Yeah, I found it under more services.
Yeah. You go here, you see all services.
Yes.
Or else you can just type, you know, search from your Active Directory. You will have it here as well. So this is how it looks. You know, you have this. As I said, you know, you can have multiple tenants. As a user, a single user can be part of multiple tenants. You can delete this tenant and I can also create one more tenant if I want from here. So when I log into Active Directory, this is how the, you know, the overview looks. If I want to go to documentations, okay, I cannot emphasize more on reading this documentation. Guys, please spend a lot of time on this documentation. And you can also see, you know, Microsoft gives you, you know, reports of your organization here. You can view that. Then you have all the users which are there in your directory. You know, you have the deleted users. Everything will understand what is data. You have groups. If you have any federated services, you will have the external identities here. In my case, I do not have them. You have roles, whichever roles are there in your, you know, for users to use. Okay. You have all these things. So this is about Active Directory. Okay. Let's basically start, you know, let's start by creating a new user. So what I'm doing, I'll just go, I'll create a user. I'll call this user as user 6. Okay. I'll use my directory name. I will not use my domain name. I'm just giving it as a name as user 6. Okay. I can auto generate a password or I can create my own password. Okay. Now I want this user to be a part of the group. As of now, no. The role of this user is normal user. Okay. And I want to give the usage locations. Let's say this user is from India. So these are the optional string and I want to give a department, I'll say HR and a job title HR admin and I say HR. So if I want to give all this information, I can, and I'll just go ahead and create. So now the user is created. So once you'll get this notification, user is created. Now you see this user created. If you want to edit the identity, you can edit, you can change, you can add the company name, employee ID, you can add the origin, let's say he is from US, you know, you can mobile number, you can do everything, and I'll save it. Okay. Now this is about users. Now, you know, let's see what are the roles this user is assigned. There are, you know, user is not assigned with
Asif. Anybody.
Yeah.
Like already in an organization, if we have, we will already have users, right? With the domain names and all.
Yeah.
So if we are going to assign, for example, there's a team of like 30 or 40 people who need access on this. So when we are creating users, is there a way we can probably replicate it from the Windows 80?
Yes, it is.
So that we don't.
Yeah. In the, you know, towards the end of today's session, we will be talking about how you synchronize your on-premise AD with Azure AD.
So when we synchronize, we'll also talk about whether these role adjustments and user groups we need to define for them, or
everything we can. So we just started with user created, and we'll just go to groups, then we'll understand the roles, everything.
Yeah.
So this is how please go
ahead. May I ask what scenarios? I know we create a account, I mean we create a user whenever it's required, but are there any specific scenarios when we are required to create a user?
Let's say, you know, a new employee joined, you want to give them access to the email, you know, email service to Azure resource. You are a developer, so you have to give them access to Azure subscription, right? To go and log into the VM or to the app service. So you are required to create users. Sometimes you are required to create lot of them, sometimes only one. Sometimes you are, you know, usually what organization do is they create the user, assign that user to group, and from the group they manage everything. So even if the user leaves your organization, the administrative task will be very less for the users. So I know we'll learn about everything. I know we'll go slowly, we'll learn everything. We just created a user. Next thing we'll do is, you know, understand the roles what a user can have. Okay. So first, you know, we'll come to this slide of Azure plans later on. Before that, you know, we will understand the roles. Okay. So in Azure AD, you have various types of roles. I have just listed few of them. One is a global administrator. Okay. So the first person who takes any Microsoft service, right, he becomes global administrator by default. So this is like, he is the boss. He has every right. Okay. He can do anything. He is having full access. He is the highest privileged user. Okay. That is the global administrator. So this usually will be the organization owner. Okay. Or the IT head of that organization, if it's a big organization. So he will be the global administrator. In small organization, you know, the IT manager can be the global admin. And then is the user administrator. You know, this, as I said, global administrator can do anything. Then you have user administrator. User administrator can create users and reset passwords. Okay. There are things which they can do, which they cannot do. This is the URL, you can go and check about the roles, whatever, you know, what are the different roles we have in Azure Active Directory. So this lists out every role. You know, you have application administrator. If you have any application which you have integrated, I talked about service principle, right? And you have an application, you know, which is in, you know, integrated with Azure AD. So that role should be given for managing that, you know, user credentials for that application. This role must be given. You have application developer role. You have authentication administrator. You have Azure DevOps administrator. There is a service in Office 365 which protects your emails, OneDrive files, Excel, PowerPoint, all those files. That's called Azure Information Protection. So you have billing administrator, you know, accounting, finances, people who makes the payment to Microsoft on the, you know, resources what you have used. For them, you will give billing administrators. So there are a lot of roles. You guys can, you know, have a look at this. You know, just go to Google and type Azure AD roles. So you will be directed to this site. So, you know, you guys go through all the roles which I have. What I have listed in the slides are the mostly used roles. Okay. You have the security administrator, billing administrator. Yeah.
Are these all are predefined administrative roles which we have to follow?
These are all predefined. You can also create custom roles if you want. These are all predefined. Okay, these roles are all predefined. If you want, you can also create custom roles. But Microsoft has taken care of almost all the things. I have rarely come across where I had to create any custom role. So they have lot of roles, you know, So you can go with, you know, under this document and see what are the roles they have. Okay.
Is it possible for you to share the syllabus, like whatever you're teaching?
Yeah,
once we are done with it, you just share the topics.
Sure, sure, definitely we'll do that. Yeah. So these are the roles, you know, what you have. So as just understand, you know, global administrator is the highest role, because most of the time we would be requiring that role to work on all the things, you know, for giving access. So how do you assign these roles? Okay. So these roles are assigned directly. You can assign them directly to the user when you create them. You can assign these roles to them through a group assignment. When they are into this group, So these roles are should be assigned to them. Let's say, for example, we have accountants. All right? We created a group called accounts team. And for that group, we have assigned a role as billing administrator. So whoever is added into that group, finance admin, you know, finance team or accounts team group, that role is automatically given to them. Okay. So you need not go and assign individual users roles. So once they are in group, that is automatically assigned. Another is rule based. So you can use rules to determine group membership. And on those, you know, on those membership, the user will be assigned those roles again. So we will do that in the practical.
Yeah.
So we just talked about, you know, the user account. To access any resource, you must have a user, you know, user account to access. And you can to manage the users, you should be a global admin, or the user admin can only manage. Security admin, billing admin, they cannot manage users. Only a global administrator and a user administrator can manage. What I mean by manage, they can create, delete the users. Password reset is also can be done. But we have one more role called password admin. He can reset the password. So let's say your organization is big, you have a help desk, and you get your users, you know, who call you often asking for password resets. So at that time, you can give this role to them, you know, password reset or user admin reset to those users who are, you know, into managing all these kinds of roles. So by default, if you delete a user, so what Microsoft does is they have the user information for 30 days. After 30 days, it is automatically deleted. But some organization wants to have the user information, you know, even after the deletion. So they have to go with other service called, you know, e-discovery, which is not part, you know, let's not go to there. So this is how the user, you know, looks. Okay, we'll go to the users again. We'll assign certain roles to users now. So I have these roles created. Okay, so I'll go to user 6 only, which we created. And I see that this, when I go to, you know, user, this user's profile, and in the profile I go to assign role, this user is not assigned anything. So it's just an a user. So I'll go to add assignment. And I'll assign him, let's say he is my finance. So I'll assign him billing administrator. So now he is the billing administrator. He can view the billing section of my tenant, you know, whole tenant. Okay. Similarly, you know, if I go to certain user, let's go to user 5. Sorry, assign roles. I'll give this user as user administrator. Okay. So now let me log in with user 5. So now, you know, I have enabled multi-factor authentication. That is the reason it is asking me to do all those things. So let's not do this here. Let's cancel this and we'll just log in. So now this user 5 is just a user. He's not having access to anything. So let's say if I go to my subscription, you know, he will not see any subscription because I have not given him any right. The only thing he can do is he can go to Active Directory. And he can create users. So as I have given him user administrator role, he is able to see the users. But if you see, the other things are grayed out for him. So he cannot do all those things. If I go to my actual global administrator account, So nothing is grayed out me because I'm the global admin. I can do anything. And I'm going to user 5. He's user 5. So he's just an user administrator. He can only use, you know, create users and manage users. So he'll see only things related to the users. Okay. I hope you're clear till now. Yeah. Based on roles, what you can do.
Can't userify assign subscriptions user administrator?
No, he cannot because he is not the global administrator, right?
Okay. Is there any specific role like a subscription administrator kind of thing where he can manage subscriptions to users?
No, it's not there as of now.
Okay.
Yeah. Because subscription billing administrator can do it. Okay.
Yeah. Billing administrator, are there any predefined roles that Azure has built in?
Yeah, they are called different roles. We'll come to that also.
Okay.
Okay. So right now we are just understanding about the tenant. Okay. So we'll understand about the tenant, then we'll go to the RBAC roles. First we'll complete the AD roles, then we'll go to RBAC roles.
The billing one which you told, that was very much understandable, but how to know to assign which role to which user?
It depends upon the user's, you know, profile. What are their activities? What are they going to do in the organization?
Okay. Which role enables what permissions?
As I said, right, this is the, you know, you have to go to this page and you have to, let's say you have an application developer, you want to give them role access, right? They will not be given to access to the AD environment, okay? Only if they are using Microsoft Identity Platform for having, you know, authentication of that application. Okay, this example is a little high, we'll not go with that. What example I can give? Okay, let's say you have a security engineer in a company, okay? His responsibility is to see what kind of attacks. He is just a cybersecurity analyst. He has to analyze all the data of Office 365 and Azure. He wants to see who is logging in, who is logging out. He wants to see the risk. He wants to identify if anyone is logging off from a different country, or, you know, all those things, you know, lot of scenarios. So what you will do for that user does not require any Azure service access. He does not require VM access. It does not require storage access. He just has to see the reports. Okay. So for those user security reports, so for that user, what you will do, you whenever, you know, let's say that user is someone, this is user 5, right? Let's say that user is user 5 again. So you will give him the security administrator role. Okay. This user will only able to see the security related things in your tenant. So all whenever other users who are just, you know, business users or people who want to sales and marketing, they don't require all these roles. You'll just create them roles and give them resources. You know, you give them email, you give them Outlook, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, you give them. And if, you know, nothing else is required for them. I hope this is clear.
Asif, got your point. I just want to check one more. I just want to confirm here. So basically the global administrator would just be like a administrator who would be handling the Active Directory in the conventional server network, right? So that guy would be assigning the access to the applications, creating anti-login and everything. So in the same way, the global administrator can do that in Azure. Am I right?
Yeah. You are right. You know, technically, even global admin can do that, but global admin is more than that in Azure.
Okay.
Okay. So okay. Here, because global admin is the owner, he is also the billing person. Because normal system administrator, he will be the admin, but okay, he will not be handling the financials of that organization, right? Mm-hmm. This guy can do that. You know, global admin can do that. He can buy subscription on behalf of the company. He can run it, and if he goes out of the organization, an organization does not know about it, then that is a problem, right? So that is the reason. That is the reason. What happens? This is usually given to the owner of the organization, and that owner, what he does, he consents, he buys all the things which are required for his, you know, organization, and with help of his IT person, he will assign all the required roles to different people. let's say you are a exchange admin, you just look after email services, so you are given only the exchange administrator role, nothing else is given to you. Okay,
got your point now.
Yeah,
thank you.
Okay,
we can state so, that global administrator is the super user here, right?
Yeah, kind of, yes, he is the super user. Yeah, Microsoft calls it a global admin. So this is about user. You can also create users bulk. I have created this bulk users before we started the class, so let me create them again. You just have to download the CSV file. If you go here, if you say create, it will give you a CSV file here which you can download. I have already downloaded it, and you can create all the users name, and you can add. Let's create bulk user 4, 5, and 6, and location. Okay, let me change this as well. So I can create multiple users. Let's say I have an organization with lot of users. I'm starting first time. So I have this option of doing creating bulk users at a time. So I gave them default password at once. I will change their I can give them all the information I want. The user location is India. So I'll just save this file and go.
We don't see the roles column there. So we don't assign the roles at the time of user creation?
No, you cannot assign them while creating it bulkily as of now. But what happens, right? I'll show you what happened behind this now. Give me 1 minute. You have seen that I have added this users in region as India, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. I'll show you again. You see that I have usage location and country I've added as India. Mm-hmm. Okay. So using this, I am getting them into a group automatically. Okay. The file is uploaded. I'm submitting. So once they get in that group, they will be able to get all the roles which are assigned to them.
So basically, the reason why I'm asking that is because when you suppose you enter into an organization, you by default you have a set of roles given to every employee, right? He'll be part of a particular distribution list, and mm-hmm. he'll have certain privileges and all. So how do you where is that where you define those privileges and those roles, and then when a user, when we are creating bulk users, how do we assign them that generic details, like those things like DLs and privileges and roles, and then specifically to his work area, then we can go ahead and assign it based on which team he's going into. But before assigning it specifically on team-based or work-based assignment, normally in an organization, when a person gets in, he by default gets a certain things of DLs and privileges and all those things added to him. So yes. That part I want to see here, actually.
Okay, yes. That happens through anywhere that happens to group membership. So, that is the reason. I'll just park your question for 1 minute. So you see that, I have given the usage location as India, right? So you just remember this. So the DLs are nothing but groups, okay? So whenever you assign, add a new user, you will add them to a group. And they will inherit all the rights of that users, okay? All that group, okay? So I have added these users. So you see, they have bulk uploaded, right? We just added user 4, user 5, user 6. Now they are member, okay? Now let me go to a group which I created earlier, which is called DG group. It's called dynamic group for administrator. Okay, let it sync for some time. So now you see I have not assigned these users into this group. So they have dynamically they have joined in this group. Okay, the reason, and they have inherited all the policies of these groups. Okay, if I can't give them any role from here, I can just directly go and give role to these users. So how did I dynamically added them to the group? So I created an expression stating if the country is India, okay, equal to India, then you add those users into this group. So automatically behind Microsoft has done them and they have added to this group. So whenever I create a user, right, I create a group which will be a dynamic group or an Office 365 group, and I can tell that anyone from this location joins, or anyone from this location, or any from on this department, all the users of that organization should be in this group. And let's say user one, he should be in the all user list, and user one should also be in the IT list. So you can define these groups and you can define these rules, and the users will automatically get added. I hope you got it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. We created the users and we have assigned them roles. Now let's create a group. As I said, you know, group, you know, there are two types of groups in Microsoft. One is Office 365 group and other is security group. So when you create an Office 365 group, this group will have an email address. Okay. It's a distribution list. Okay. And when you create a security group, you will not have a distribution list, but that is a group. The reason Microsoft has this is there are certain products of Microsoft which are assigned to groups only. Those are security products. So for that reason, you have to create these groups. The other thing what you can do is, you know, membership type. You can have three kinds of membership. One is assigned. What I mean by assigned is I have to go manually assign users into the group. Other is dynamic, based on certain condition, the users will automatically get added to the group. And dynamic device. Device is for the device. Because Microsoft has Windows Active Directory, right? You can manage your mobile phones, laptops, and desktops. So if you want to add those devices also into your organization's objective, then you can use this group as well. Okay. So let's create a Office 365 group. Let's call this PSF group one. Okay. So it will take this email address also. I'll say PSF group one and I'll keep it as assigned. Okay. And I'll create it. So this group will be created and this group will be also assigned an email address. So if someone sends an email, so any member who is user is member of this group, they will receive an email from that DL also. Okay. And as of now, there is a no member. You can go and you can add members to this. Owner is the person who can be owner. So usually the person who creates the group, he becomes the owner, but you can add multiple owners if you want. So you can add
a doubt over here. Can we go to the back option? I mean, like, for the dynamic distribution group we have discussed, right?
We'll create that group now. Okay. We'll create that group. So let me do one thing. I'll go to groups now again. And I'll create a dynamic group. So what we are creating is we are creating a security group. Okay. We'll call it dynamic group PSF. One. Okay. I'll give a description same. And I'll say this is a dynamic, and I'll add myself as the owner. Okay. Okay. Now I have to give the dynamic user members. I have to add the dynamic query. So who will be part of my users? So any if I have, these are all the properties with which you can create the dynamic group. Okay. You have all this and you can also create your custom. Okay. Based on your organization. Let's say we will be creating based on let's say you have multiple tenant. You can create on principal name, multiple domain names. You have psf1.com, psf2.com. You want to add them in different group, right? You can do that using principal name. But in our case, let's do with usage location or country. We'll say country. And then you have operators. So all and on, you can use all these things. I'll use equal and I'll say US. So I just created a dynamic, and I'll save it. And I'll create. So now what happens when if I create a user whose country's location is USA, US, so that user will automatically come into this group. Okay. If I want to edit this, I can also edit it. I go to properties and I can edit that. Okay. I see no member and I cannot assign member to dynamic groups from here. Okay. They have to get added to the dynamic query. I cannot manually override that. If I go to dynamic rules membership, you will see what is the dynamic query I have given. Okay. So now let's go and create a user with the user whose usage location is USA.
Can't we edit user 6 to this and then can we?
Yeah, we can do that. User 6 is already US, so he should be in that group by now. So it's evaluating, right? Once it is completed, the user 6 will be inside this membership. So anything with Microsoft will take some time, but it will come. As you can see, I'll just go to the other example. We created this group, right? Not this group. This group, and we added bulk user 4, 5, and 6, and we gave them India, and these users here, because the dynamic membership rule was country equal to India, the user should come into this group. So these users were added. So similarly, this user will also get added into the US group. It's still evaluating. So once this evaluation is done, it will show completed and you will see the time, and in the progress, and you will see the member here.
Okay. If we have selected a manual option, manually adding rather than this. Mm-hmm. So is there any option that we can like bulk add them like using CSV file or something?
You can definitely add them using bulk add. So if I go, we created this group, right? With this group. So if I want to add them, I have the bulk activity here. I can add them bulk import. So I give the member. If I want my users to be also in this group, I just go. Okay, the CSV format is different. You just have to download that CSV format. And you have to fill that and add those users.
Okay.
Yeah. So you have that option also. Okay. But dynamic groups, you cannot add them manually. They should come through the dynamic query only. Okay. I hope it is clear till here.
Yeah.
Any questions, others?
My question is regarding domain. I'm still confused that it is giving custom domain option. So what is the importance for the custom domain and why is it giving like options up to 990?
Yeah. Can you please? So in some organizations, let's say a big organization, right? They have multiple domains. Okay. For example, my company, right? We have two domains. We have two companies. We have two domains. So other organizations, they have multiple domains. Big organizations, they have subdomains, right? Let's say, for example, sap.com is there. So you will have india.sap.com. You will have usa.sap.com. So that is the reason they have all those things. You can create users with all those names. It's okay. Clear now?
Yes. And even...
Yeah, I lost you. Your voice is breaking.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
And also maybe like if some companies will have sister companies as well. So for that users, right?
Yes. So if they want to manage within the same tenant, they can do that. Okay. So you have two options. You can manage two companies in two different tenants. You can manage your two sister companies in same tenant if you want to do. That is up to you because Microsoft gives you option of adding multiple domains. You have to just go verify that and you have to add it. The other way you can see about your domains is going to portal.office.com. Because as I said, directory is unique across the place. You go and you see, I do not have Office applications. So that is the reason you are not seeing that for this tenant. But I'll sign in to my another tenant. You will see it. Okay, let me not sign into this. So you have one more admin, you will have an admin center here. This is for Office 365. So you can manage all your Office 365. Let's say you are not having Azure, you are having just Office 365. This is the portal you will log into. So you have the same option of verifying your domain here also. Okay. I have not verified the domain. You see, this is my tenant name, different tenant name, which is on Microsoft.com. But you can verify this user. And you will have also have Active Directory here, just the Azure Active Directory. And you can manage this. Okay. Your all the users here. So this Active Directory will be basic. You will have just the users whom you can manage. But as I said, you have different usernames, right? So you see, you have compliance admin, security admin, Exchange admin, SharePoint admin, Microsoft Teams admin. You can see all the admins which are there available for Office 365 users. So these all are AD roles. Okay. So you can assign the roles. You can also create the users from here. Azure AD is simpler. This is, you know, different. Then if you have any license like Office 365, you can assign these licenses here to the users and you can create users from here also. So this is only for Office 365 purpose. So now you cannot have, you know, when you are using email, when you are sending and receive email, you will not be using brio.demo on Microsoft.com. You will be using your company's domain name. So for that reasons, you will verify the domain name here so that you can create usernames with those names, with that domain name. So there are two different things. One is tenant name, another is domain name. So do not get confused in that. So tenant name is a default name which is given by Microsoft. You can create users with this tenant name if you want. But as a best practice, what companies do is they do not use this. They verify the domain. Then they create users and they assign roles. I hope this is clear now.
Yes, thank you.
Great. So let me sign out of this. Okay. So the other thing I wanted you guys to see is a single user can be a part of multiple domains, right? So I have an email ID. Okay, so I'll just log into that. I'll say portal.azure.com. So I am this user. Okay. This is my work account. So I have multi-factor authentication implemented. So you can see I have logged in with my company's ID, but I also have option to switch directory. So these are all the directories which have, these are all different companies to whose directory I can go and join and log into their directory, because these guys have invited me. As I said, right, a subscription can belong to a single directory and a user can belong to multiple directory and can have access to multiple subscription and different tenants. So me, Asif user, is having access to all these four directories and all their resources in that directory. Okay. So how do you do this? How do the people get this access? Okay. They do it by inviting them. So if I go to a user, you can invite a guest user. So this guest user can be anyone with a different domain name. So if someone can volunteer and give me their email address, then that would be great in the chat. I would like to invite them. Is someone giving me their email address, or I should use mine? Okay, let me use mine again. So I have already went ahead, you know, I gave them role also. I can assign roles from here if I want to give them any role. These are external users. So what I have done before this class is I have invited, you know, my personal Gmail account. If you see, you will have this Gmail account, right? I have invited this user. I have not given him any permission. So just me go and log in into my Gmail. So this is the Gmail I have. So you will see, I will receive an, you know, invitation email stating that, you know, this company with this tenant name default directory has invited me. So I can go and I can accept it. So by now it is asking me to, you know, it will send a code to me to verify that, you know, the user. So I'll get one more email, which will be from Microsoft with the verification code. So mine is a Gmail account. It is not a Microsoft account, but right now it is converting into a Microsoft account. No accept. So I do not have any rights as of now because I have not given anything to this user. Okay. So now you will see that I am into the directory, but I do not have access to anything. Okay. So now let's go and give access to Asif. So if I go to, okay, let me sign out of this. Okay, let me go to my directory. If I refresh, you see that's invited, right? So now you see OTP. So it has changed. That means I have accepted. Now I am going to Asif. I am going to roles. And I am assigning him a role. He is outside the organization. He is not within my organization. I am making him global admin. This is not a good practice, but you know, in our case, I can make it. So now he's a global admin. So now I'll just go. I will just, you know, view my account. I can see all the information which I want, as of now, which I don't have, but I'll go and add password to it if I want to. So because it's an OTP user, you will not have access to this. So I'll just sign out and then sign again. So now you see, I got this Azure app. So it will take some time, but this will definitely work. I can go and view. Okay, no, the problem is it is taking a different user here. It is taking user 4. Okay, now I got it. So I have to log out of this user first. So it will send again a code to me. So basically this should work. Let's give us some time. It will definitely work on that. Okay, I have not given him Azure permission, right? So that is the reason I'm unable to see it. But he's able to give me directly. Okay, my bad. Okay, we'll go to this again. You know, once we go to the RBAC roles, we will give this user Asif the owner role for Azure subscription. We just gave him a role to a directory. We made him global admin, but we have not given him an Azure rights, right? So when we talk about Azure RBAC roles, we will do that. So till now it is clear, right? You can invite users also outside the users organization and you can assign them licenses. Any questions still here? Except the, you know, the invite user, any other questions? Okay, so I'll assume no questions. I'll go forward. So as you said, we can create two users, right? Security groups and Office 365 group. We can assign the membership assigned, which is manually dynamic users and dynamic device. Okay, so before you can assign the users, there are few things which you have to, you know, make sure that, you know, the users are, you know, associated with multi-factor authentication and self-service password reset. So how do you do that? So you go to Azure Active Directory, you go to user, and here you will have multi-factor authentication. So you see all these users, you know, there are a few users who are associated, you know, with multi-factor authentication. For user force, it is enforced. You know, it was enforced by the organization. These are disabled. And if you see enabled, there is no enabled user. And if you see enforced, you have one user. I have enforced this user to do multi-factor authentication, but there are no others. What you can do, you can select this user, any user, let's say user 5, and you can enable them. So whenever the user logs in, he has to do multi-factor authentication, otherwise he will not able to log in back. So let's do that. So now this is user 5, we have already logged in. We'll try to log in again. We have to give some time for this to work, to enforce. So now it is saying that, you know, we require more information because we have enabled multi-factor. It will ask us to, you know, do all those things. How do you want to authenticate? You have to give your phone number. You know, you have to give everything and do multi-factor authentication. Okay. The other thing, you know, I'm not doing it, but you have to do it to log in. Without that, you will not be able to log in now.
If one more thing to add over here is like we can customize multi-factor authentication as well, right? Instead of selecting all options, we can only give like authentication through app as well.
Yes, you can do.
We can enable only that as well.
Yes. So if you go here, right? So other is you are enabling. Yes, you can do that. You have these authentication methods. So in this authentication methods, you can give them one method or you can give them two methods, and you can say mobile app notification or mobile app code. You want to do all those things, you can do. For that to happen, the users have to go and download that Microsoft Authenticator app and they have to register their account. Okay. If you give this option, they will have that option to do that multi-factor authentication also. Okay. But right now I'm giving this them email and phone. And I'm saying only one is enough. If they do one authentication, it is more than enough for me. And you can have more than one also. You can have two. You also have security questions. You can give security questions if you want. You can have, you have option of giving 5. You can do that. Okay. And this is also for multi-factor authentication and self-service password reset. Let's say users have forgot the password and they want to reset the password. Okay. So they have to do this. So, you know, I will be asked to, you know, authenticate that. Let me go to, give me 1 minute.
So Asif, one more doubt over here. The self-service password works only for cloud users, right? If at all the users who are integrated with on-premise AD, they won't be able to reset their password, right?
Yeah, we will come to that. We'll come to that.
Okay.
Yeah. So now it's asking me to authenticate, but what I'll do, I'll just say that, you know, I have forgot the password. So this is automatically taking me into that. So I have, you know, no password. This user is having multi-factor authentication enabled. So every time I do that, I have to give this. This is enforced for this user. So this users, you know, I have enforced these users. I've logged in. Okay. Let me try with a different user because this user is enforced, right? So it's all multi-factor authentication for this user. I hope you got the gist, right? The user can reset the password automatically once we enable this. And you will see all the registrations whichever happened. And you want the users to register whenever they sign in. You have to keep it as, and you can set the days when, you know, the user has to, you know, register again. So I kept it at 180. And if you want notifications to, you know, happen, you can notify to all the admins, okay, whenever there is password reset happening. And you can also give a help desk link if you want. You know, some organization have their service desk if they are using any ITSM tool. So they will give that link here to do that. So you see this on-premise registration. So with this, you know, there's things you have to do. Password write back. So when we come into Azure AD Connect, right? So you will see this password write back. Then with this help, you can also do self-service password reset of on-premise Windows Active Directory users. So I, you know, this is your answer to your question. You can do it, but we'll come to that in later stages.
Okay.
So this is all about, you know, Windows Active Directory. We have to understand about the next thing is about RBAC roles. Yeah, someone had a question?
No. I just want to know that is it in a purchased one or else like is it comes under a subscription, free subscription kind of?
Yeah, thing? It is a free, it comes with subscription. There are, you know, okay, the important thing you have to understand is the Azure, I am not good with Zoom. Just give me 1 minute. If you go to Azure AD Premium plans, okay, so we will discuss about the paid plans and free plans of Azure just in a minute. We'll do that. Before that, we'll understand what is you know, the RBAC roles. So this RBAC roles, you know, these are called role-based access controls. These roles are specifically for Microsoft Azure subscription. Okay, Active Directory roles are across all the tenants, okay, across all the services of Microsoft, but RBAC roles are specifically just for Microsoft Azure. These roles are not available in Office 365 or M365 or Dynamics 365. These roles are available only in Azure. So these roles helps you manage access to Azure resources, okay? Whatever VM, storage, load balancer, you know, web server, anything, those roles can be managed using RBAC roles, okay? So these three are the major roles. There are a lot of built-in roles to cover most common security scenarios, but you have option of also creating custom roles if you want using JSON script, okay? But you know, as we have the global admin role, right? Here we have a role called owner. So this guy owner, he can do anything, okay? He's just like global administrator. Global administrator can do anything in the tenant. Owner can do anything in the Azure subscription, okay? You can be a global administrator, but you cannot be a owner. Okay. You can be a normal user. You can be a owner. So these roles we have to play with, you know, based on the our companies or our requirement. Contributor can create and manage types resources, but cannot give access to others. Owner can only give access. Okay. And reader can read only. Okay. Contributor can do, reader can read, owner can do anything. Okay. So you will have owner, contributor and reader at the subscription level, you have at the resource group level, and you have at the resource level. So we will understand this slowly. You just understand that you have these three major roles. You have other roles also, like VM contributor, backup contributor, VM reader, backup reader, storage contributor, storage reader. So you have all these roles. So how do you assign this? You go to the scope where you want to assign it, and you'll do it. So how does this RBAC roles work? Okay. So the way you control access to resource in Azure is RBAC roles, right? So there are three things. You do it by role assignment. So how do you do the role assignment? To do the role assignment, you have to have three things. One is the security principle. Okay, I am not talking about service principle, which we spoke about AD roles. This is separate. Security principle. Security principle can be a user, group, or a service principle. Then you define the role. What role? Owner, contributor, or reader. Then you define the scope at what level. Okay. So you see, I am assigning a role. So these are security principle. A user can be a security principle. Who is a user? User from Active Directory. He is a security principle here. Active Directory group is a security principle. Service principle of Active Directory is a security principle. And manage identity. Your on-premise or federated identities can also be your security principle. Okay. Then you create a definition. So this role is a contributor. So this group, this security principle can have this role. Okay. And at this scope, at what scope? At subscription or at resource group or at resource. At what level can we assign them? Okay. So this is, as I said, security, who is security principle, the role definition, what actions, when you define a role, it says, what action this role can do, whether they can change, at what authorization can do, can they delete or can they write? All these are managed by using these roles. Okay. So let's go and assign a role to someone. Okay. So I will go.
One more thing. Yeah. It's like after we assigning subscriptions to a user, we also need to assign a RBAC roles as well.
Right now, no one is having a role to this subscription except me. Okay. Even though I have created, this is my subscription, right? Let's say I want to assign RBAC role at subscription level. So this is the scope I have selected. I want to assign an RBAC role at subscription level. I'll go to the subscription. Okay. And I'll go to access control IAM. Okay. Sorry for that, guys. My kids are, And I see assignment. Now I go. These are all the roles which are there for me, which I can assign to my users. I have lot of roles. Okay. So I rarely see, requirement of using custom role. So I want to give a owner role for this subscription to my user 4. Okay. I will go and I'll select user 4. Okay. Before I do that, he's already owner. Okay. Let me log into user 4 first. So you see user 4, he is already the owner of the subscription. Okay. So I gave him the role. So let me use it. Okay. Let me go here. I see role assignments. So what I have done, I gave him VM contributor. Okay. So I'll remove this user from. Sometimes, to make it enforced, we have to log in and log out.
Thank you.
So now you see, I have access to the subscription. I am the owner of this subscription. And I can give access to whomever I want also. Okay, as the owner, I can do anything. So I gave this role to this user. Okay, I have not given, right?
Yeah.
So now see, you are unable to see anything. Okay. I am able to go to the subscription, but I am unable to do anything. Okay. So now let me add this user 4 as the owner of this subscription. Owner means the super. Okay, he can do anything. And I'm that too, I am giving at the subscription level. So he can do anything at the subscription. So the role is assigned.
So what's the best practice we follow over here, Asif?
Okay, so let's say you have a system administrator who has to manage certain types of VMs, right, in Azure. So you just give him VM contributor role at that resource level only. You do not give him access to the whole subscription. Okay. So as I said, whole subscription is only given to the owner of the organization. So when we go into virtual machines and, you know, network, so we'll assign roles there as well.
So it will take time. Subscription is different and resource is different, right?
Yes. So, you know, has been authorized, does not have authorization to perform action. So role is not assigned till now. So it will get assigned very soon. It will take some time. So when what you can do is, you know, this is at subscription level, I'm assigning this resource, right? The role. Other things, what I can do is I can assign at VM level. I created one VM, which is called VM1. And I can give roles here also. I can give roles at here also. So I can give a role assignment here. I can make them owner, or I can make them contributor. I can do that. I'm doing at resource level. Okay, this is the VM. At VM, I'm giving the role. So they will, when they log in, they will just see this VM. They will not see any other resources what I have. Okay. If I go to my resource, I have resource groups also. So resource groups are nothing but you group resources under resource group. Okay. Similar project, logically grouping of resources are done under resource group. So for this trial purpose, I created a resource group called PSF RG1. In this resource group, I have created all these resources. I have created a VM. I have created a virtual network. I have an IP address. I have a network security group. I have a network interface. I have a hard disk. I have created all these resources here. I can assign this permission at the subscription level, or I can do it at resource group level, or I can do at the resource level. Okay. Let's say I am a network administrator. I want this guy to only have virtual network access. I'll go at the virtual network and I'll give him access here. So these are the granular controls what you can have in your organization. Okay.
So as if here, like VM is one service, right? So resource, yes, referred to as a service.
Service, yeah, service is a service. Yeah, in Azure terms, it is called resource.
Okay.
Yeah. So any services what you use, those are resources. Resources are nothing but the services in Azure. So how you manage group those services using resource group? Resource group is just a logical grouping of the resources. Okay. And subscription is a subscription what you have. Okay. So this is about the role definition. And you can, if you want to see the definition of any roles, you can do it PowerShell, or you can just go and, you know, to the RBAC role, and you can see those subscriptions definitions also. So this is how the definition looks. You know, the contributor will have the name as contributor. Sorry. This is the subscription ID. Okay. The subscription ID, and is the custom? No, it is not custom. It is this is pre-built role. Okay. And this contributor lets you manage everything except access to resources. Okay. And what you can do, you cannot delete, you cannot write. Okay. These are no actions. actions are star means everything you can do except these actions. You cannot delete it. You cannot write it. Okay. You cannot give authorizations to anyone. You can manage the resource, but you cannot give authorizations. Okay. In the contributor role, who can give the authorizations to other users? Who can give authorizations to other users? Only owner. Okay.
Owner.
If you look at the owner role, he can give access to everyone. Okay. So this slide will help you understand how the AD roles and things work. So admin roles are at the tenant level. Okay. RBAC roles are the subscription level. Okay. So you can have RBAC roles at the subscription level. You can have RBAC role on the resource group level. Again, you can have the at the resource level. Okay. And AD roles are at the tenant level. Okay. You can be a normal user. You need not have an admin access in AD, but you can be a owner of the subscription. That is possible. Okay. So this is the GitHub repository where you know a lot of people have contributed about the custom roles, and they have created a lot of roles. You can go and look at this. And this Git repository has a lot of custom, or the people have built a lot of custom roles, right? Which has Microsoft taken into in built-in roles. But if new roles comes, you can go and check it out on the GitHub list. I will give you these slides, at the end of this, bootcamp. You can have a look at that. So these are the documentation I advise you to go and read about Active Directory groups and users and everything. Okay. We have done multi-factor authentication also, right? You have seen, you can have different authentication methods. So how multi-factor works is, with password, with something you have, with something you know, and something you bring, right? With your biometrics, something you are, sorry. So you can do all those things. So as of now, this biometrics only works for application integration, not for Azure AD or RBAC roles. Okay. So these are the multi-factor methods available within Microsoft. You can have username, password. You can do it to multi-factor authentication for multi-factor authentication, also for self-service password reset. If you have fast identity security key, you can only do it for your AD roles. Okay, for multi-factor authentication only, you cannot do self-service password reset with that. So is the case with OAuth software tokens and hardware tokens. For service principles, if you want to have multi-factor authentication, then you can do with software tokens or hardware tokens. Okay.
Asif, now, question regarding MFA, multi-factor authentication. Mm-hmm. Is it mandatory to use only Microsoft's MFA process or app, or can use the Google MFA as well?
You can use Google, but it usually gives a lot of problems. So Microsoft is best.
Okay. But I've been using for my AWS console. I've been using Google.
Microsoft is like little, how can you say? Sort of possessive. Yeah, he is very possessive. So he requires only Microsoft Authenticator app. It works with Google Authenticator or any other authenticator app, but with MFA of Microsoft, it works good. Okay.
Okay.
As I said, so now comes the other topic where Microsoft shines, which is called conditional access. Okay. So what is conditional access? Am I going too fast? Should we stop here, or how you guys, can you continue? Because I have more 4 topics to cover.
So we can. I mean, this is good.
Great. So other is conditional access. So basically what simple terms, if you meet certain conditions, then only you are given access. Even if you have multi-factor authentication, even if you have self-service password reset, you are using, a Microsoft Authenticator app, you are using code, anything. Even then you are not secure. Okay. So what Microsoft done is they have come up with another service called conditional access. So what is this conditional access? Based on certain conditions, based on certain signals, you are authenticated to use. Okay. And these are enforced. You have to do it no matter what. There is no choice for you to, have a workaround of this. So you have to do it. So based on certain condition, they are just if statements. You have this, then you can do this. Okay. Do that nothing if then statements. So if with this statements, you are granted access. Okay. So prerequisite to do this, okay? One is you should have the premium plan, okay? Premium plan one, premium plan two, or this license of Microsoft, which is called Enterprise Mobility and Security. If you directly go to, you know, free trial, you will not have the you know, conditional access feature, okay? So what you have to do is, you have to go to a site called Microsoft EMS, you know, and sign up for the trial. They'll give you 1 month trial, okay? So you go here and you see start free trial. With the same ID with what you have created, you can do it from here, okay? Or else you can do it from here also directly, okay? So I go to Active Directory, okay? I go to security, then I see conditional access. So if you do not have this premium license, let me open this. If I do not have this premium license, if you do not see Azure AD Premium Plan 2, then you will not be able to do this, okay? This comes with price. So we will just, so these are the plans which are available. So when you sign up, right, without any service, you will get this free account. So with this, you can do, you know, you can create users group, you can do device registrations, this device registration of mobiles, you can do AD sync with your on-premise AD. You can do multi-factor authentication, you can do all those things. But there are certain things like, you know, if you want to do company branding, you want to have your logo when people sign in, then you should at least have Office 365 or Plan 1 on Plan 3, okay, Plan 2, sorry. And then you want to have, you know, self-service password reset, you cannot do it with free, you have to have these three. So when you sign up, you get this, okay? You get Office 365 apps sign up, you will not get this. Right now, when you sign up, you have this. That is the reason you are able to do all these things, okay? You have security reports, and you have, you know, self-service password reset for cloud users. These are the premium features. You have password protection. You can ban certain kinds of password. You know, password, jo password rakhte na log, you can ban all those things. Password protection for your Windows server, okay? You want premium plan one and plan two. You want to do self-service reset, change, unlock with your on-premise. Someone has asked this question, right? How you will be able to do that? So for that, you have to have premium plan one and plan two, okay? You have group access management. You can only do it with premium plan one and plan two, okay? There is a CASB product of Microsoft, which is called Cloud App Discovery, okay? This, which is not, will it not go to this? And there are other features also which are available with, you know, the premium plan one. What we are focusing on is conditional access, identity protection, and identity governance. But these three, we require premium plan two, okay? So which cost you around, you know, $9 per user. This cost you $6 per user every month. In Indian currency, it will be different. So you can just go and sign up for this product. So this product will give you all these three features, okay?
So can you give an example of conditional access, scenario you must have come across?
Yeah, we are going there. So, okay, one scenario what we had, right? We have one company, we are into, you know, interior designing and all. So they make a lot of documents and they are using SharePoint, OneDrive, you know, and their application is also hosted in Azure. So they do not want their users to access their office data except from the laptop what they have given to them, okay? They cannot log in from phones and all. So in Windows Active Directory, you can ask them to join from your IP address and all, right? So similarly, you can do it here. Now you can create a policy, okay? So I'll just create my own policy. So I'll go to Windows Active Directory first. I have this license, okay? That is the reason I'm able to do. I'll go to security. I go to conditional access and I'll create an access, okay? So I'll say this is user compliance. policy. Okay, I'll just give some name. Then I'll go, I'll select where should I want this policy to get enforced. Should I want on all users or should I want on selected users? So I'll say selected users, I'll select one group. So now the group here should be a security group. An Office 365 group cannot be used here, okay? Okay, I have created certain groups, right? So I'll use this group and I'll select. Now what I'll do, I'll exclude myself because I don't want that to get enforced on me. So I'll exclude myself. You can also exclude someone. So now I am creating these policies. This policy is for these users who are in this group, okay? Then I go to cloud apps. If I want to do any app things, which I do not want to do right now, I just want to give them access. If I want to give them apps, I can do all apps or I can select the apps to which they can have access from here. Whatever apps are there in my organization, I want them to log into Azure portal only when they, you know, have access. Okay. I want them to access Azure whenever they are into, they meet this criteria of conditional access, which will not do it here. Okay. I'll say none. Now, what are the conditions? Okay. Based on user risk. Okay. If it's medium, I'll select that. So what is this is, you know, you are configuring user risk to apply policies. Okay. Whenever it's medium risk, right? The user is applied, you know, this policy is applied to that user. Okay. Sign in risk. Yes. I'll say it medium. And if I want to enforce this on device platform, right? I said yes. Select. And I'm doing whenever user is accessing from Windows device. Location. Now I want them to only log in from my, you know, IP address range. So I have to go and create, you know, the trusted location, which I have not created till now. But I can do that. Right now I'm giving any location. Okay. I'll just say next. What I have to do, if they meet, okay, if they are into risk and all those things conditions, then you can block the access. Okay. So what I'm doing, if someone from Windows device is trying to log in to Azure services, I am blocking the access. So they will not have access. But in our case, we will give access. They will get access only if they require to do multi-factor authentication. The device should be compliant. The device should be domain joined. Okay. And you require all of them or you require only one of them. So for me, I want these three conditions to be met. They should meet multi-factor authentication. They should join from a device which is compliant. And they should also join from the domain joined join. So if you are a Windows background, if you go to your computers, right, you will see, you know, in the properties, you will see your domain. So you see, I am, you know, this is my computer, right? So I do not have any domain. So if I have a domain joined device, then only I will be able to access. So this is how you manage the access. So if they are logging in from their personal laptops, then you will not be able to, you know, give them, they'll not be able to access it. Okay. And I've selected and I've created. Now this policy is applied to all those users. Okay. Is it clear till now?
Yeah, Asif, one more thing is like, anyways, we have enabled multi-factor authentication, right? So, what's the difference between these two? I mean, like conditional that, access and multi-factor.
Yeah, that multi-factor authentication is similar to this, but apart from that, we are also telling that, you know, their device should be compliant, okay? And their device should be a domain joined device, okay? You can do multi-factor authentication from any, any device, right? From your phone or someone else's laptop. But in this scenario, you will only do it from your domain joined device, the device which your company has given you. Okay.
Mr. Asif.
Yeah.
Till now, what all we have done is through the web access, like web on Azure portal.azure.com, right?
Yes. Yes.
And now, just now you have mentioned in the securities that it should be integrated with the domain. Mm-hmm. Do this Azure integrates with the domain controller in our organization?
Yes, it does.
So there is no separate domain controller in Azure?
No. So what we do is, you know, there is a managed service if you want to do that. But if you already have an on-premise environment, right? So there is a service called, I'll just go to that service. It's called hybrid identity. Hybrid identity. So you have AD Connect, okay, which was called AD Sync previously. Now it's called AD Connect. With that tool, we will, you know, synchronize our on-premise AD to Azure AD. Okay. So that's how you make your domain join. But if you take premium plan 2, right, you do not require this also. You can directly go and domain join any device, okay, with the user. I will do that also.
Okay.
Yeah. So in that on-premise AD you can do. But here, as you are using premium plan 2, this premium plan 2 will, you know, give you the ability to domain join directly with your email ID. You do not require them to go to work and group. They just go to this, you know, you have this work account here, right? Work account, right? You just go to set account. So I have my work access account, right? If you see, my device is domain joined to my company's directory through Azure AD. So I'm not using Windows device, Windows AD. I'm using, I just go here. If I disconnect, I'll go out of it. I just give my username and password and my device becomes domain joined to my AD, company's AD. Okay. So the users normally, you know, the administrator need not do this. The user can directly go and they can just log in, sign in from here, and their device is domain joined. Now, once this policy is enforced, what we have created, so the user can do this from here only, okay? And other things, what apart from this, one we have said domain joined, other what we can do is, we can create named locations. Let's say we have certain IP addresses, which we want users to log into, or certain countries which are allowed. We can give those countries, our users are in India and USA. So if the user is from India, then only they'll Microsoft allow them to log in. Okay. And if you have any IP address range, okay, you can give that IP address range, public IP address range. So whenever the user in that IP address range only, let's say we have an Hyderabad office IP range. I'm just giving an example. Okay. I'm taking this range. This is private IP, but you know, let's think that this is public range. So when I create this and I assign the policy to this IP address, so whenever users are the in this IP address only, they will log in. Otherwise, they'll not be able to log in. Okay. I just keep the condition. I go to location. I say selected location. I should have Hyderabad IP here, Hyderabad office here. And I select. So whenever the user is logging in from Hyderabad office IP address range only, the user will log in. Okay. So this was typically done using Windows Active Directory, in the traditional way. But now because Microsoft have moved their identity to the cloud, so you cannot have users accessing, you know, from anywhere in the world, right? So this is how you give the restrictions. So let's say your scenario is, your users should log in only when they are within the office. They should not log in from their home. Then you can give this policy assigned to all the users. So they will only log in when they're in the IP. You go, you know, what is my IP? You will get your, you know, IP range, public IP range. And if you have any VPN or, you know, firewall, a gateway with public IP, then you can give that IP address also. Okay. And you can have custom controls also, which is new in preview. As I said, you know, you had VPN connectivity, right? If you have any VPN, then also you can do that. So we have created few policies. So this is about conditional access. So you are giving access based on certain conditions. So you can go and create certain policies. Make sure you always exclude your, you know, global admin. Because if you create any policy and you are not able to log in, then you know, you'll have to take help of Microsoft to do that. So whenever you're practicing, you exclude yourself. You go and you exclude yourself first. So you create conditional policies and see how things are, you know, working. And you can block and grant access. So let's say we have created, anyone is not logging in from the trusted IP, block it. Do not give them access. So you can do that. So I hope it is clear till now. So as I said, you know, you can do all these things. Common users, you know, if you are common signals, what are the signals? If you are from a user or a group membership, then only based on that signal, you can give grant and block the access. Based on your geographical information and IP location, you can give and block and grant access based on your device, based on the risk. Okay, there is one. Next topic is identity protection. So based on risk, you can, you know, restrict access to your Azure. Okay, so what are the decision? You can block, which is the most restricted decision, and you can give access based on certain conditions, you know, domain joined devices, required client app, all those things. So when do you commonly use this, you know? So you require multi-factor authentication for your users with administrative roles. Okay, for those users you can use conditional access. Okay, so these are certain scenarios where you can, you know, block the users, you know, use conditional access. If you have, you know, blocking based on risk behavior, you can do that. So next product of Microsoft, you know, which comes with premium plan 2 is identity protection. So there is nothing much in this module. Okay, we have to just enable it. So what this does, it detects any risk. Okay, I mean, if you ask that risk to be remediated, it will remediate it, and later on you can give your security team to investigate using any, you can pull the same information to any other SIM tool, and you can, you know, remediate, you know, you can analyze what is happening in an environment. So how do you do that? As I said, you require premium plan 2 license for this. So how do you detect the risk? Okay, so risk can be detected in following classification. One is user based risk, other is user sign in risk. Okay, so this is done automatically by Microsoft. You are not required to do anything. So how Microsoft does it? It does based on calculation. Some calculations are real time and some are offline, which take some time for Microsoft to identify. Okay, for example, these are the identifications which Microsoft does. You are trying to log in from a different IP location, which you are not allowed to do. So Microsoft will automatically identify that risk and it will block. Okay, you are logging from anonymous IP. Let's say you have used third-party VPN providers to block your IP address. Okay, you are in India, you are using USA IP address. Even then Microsoft will block, it will not allow you to join. Okay. Okay, if you have sign-in properties which are unfamiliar, you know, Microsoft will study, the machine learning algorithm behind will study, you know, your behavior over the period of time. And if something is changed, then it will ask you to, you know, it will block your access first. Then it will ask you to, you know, do multi-factor authentication or contact your administrator. Okay, if you are logging in from any malicious IP address, Microsoft has lot of database of malicious IP. So if you have those malicious IP, then it will block. If Microsoft comes to know, these are sign-in risk. Okay, and the user risks are, then the user risks are like, one second. Okay, the user risks, let's say Microsoft will come to know whether your credentials are leaked. Okay, there is a lot of leaked database right in the market. Every day we see a lot of reports that, you know, this information of these companies have leaked. If Microsoft will evaluate that database, and if your email address or your phone number is with that leaked database, so Microsoft will block and ask you to do a lot of, you know, verifications before that. Okay, so this is about identity threat protection. So we'll just go directly. Any question?
Asif, I have a question here. In the previous slide, which you were talking about the risk and all. So in case if the first option, the atypical offline, okay, in that also will Azure will block the person, the ID first, or it will only restrict?
It will block the ID first. Then it will ask you to do certain, you know, meet certain conditions. Then only okay. It will give you access.
Okay. In case if the user fails to produce that or pass through that conditions,
he'll be blocked.
He'll be blocked completely.
Yeah, he'll be blocked. Yes.
Then he need to go back to directly to the global admin, right?
Yeah. No, not the global admin. Any administrator who has, you know, who can give him, you know,
the actual access again.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Got it.
Okay. You can also, if you want to create, this is the identity protection platform. How do you go to it? You go to Active Directory first. You go to security, and you have identity protection. Okay. So you know you have this. You can go and create user risk policies. Okay. If you want to create, you can create. Microsoft has already predefined. If you want to create, you can do. You can create for all users. You can set the condition level. I'll say medium to above. Okay. If it's medium to above, then this this should force. What are the control access you can give? You can block it, or you can grant them access based on certain things. But okay. We usually block it. Okay.
Got it.
Okay. We block it. This is not a good practice.
Mm-hmm.
This will ask to change the required password chain, but it's better we block it if the risk is high. Okay. For medium and low risk, you can, you know, give them access and require, ask them to change the password. Okay. So Microsoft has automatically, they have, it has classified, and you enforce this policy on all the users. So let me exclude myself first. So make sure you exclude yourself. Otherwise, you know, you will block all yourself, right? I'll exclude this also. And I can save this policy, and this policy will create it. So whenever the, you know, user risk is medium and, you know, above, it will ask, it will grant access, and it will ask us to change the password. But you know, if the risk is high, okay, so you create a policy which is high, and you block it to save, you know, your data. Then you can also have you know, policies based on sign-in risk. Okay, you can have conditions of, you know, again at sign-in risk. You know, we have that atypical location, malicious links, and all those things, right? So Microsoft will automatically calculate all those things, and based on that, you can assign these policies. And you can view all the reports here. Okay, you can see who is your risky user. I do not have a risky user as of now. You can see what were the risky sign-ins, people who were blocked, you know, who were granted access, and you can see risk detections, what Microsoft is doing, you know, what detections it has done. So you can see this. Then you can also have alerts created. You know, you can have you can create alerts which sends you an email. Okay, or you can integrate your, you know, monitoring tool. Okay, if you have any email ID for iAlerts, you want you know, these people to get notified, you have an email ID which is, you know, associated with your monitoring tool. You create that email address, and you can give that email address here, so it will send you an email there, you know, to alerts. You can have additional emails also. Okay, so by default it has, you know, for high risk it has taken all the global administrators. Okay. So this is about, you know, identity protection. So there's nothing much, you know, it's already done by Microsoft, but just you need a license to do all these things. The last topic, you know, what we'll be covering in Azure AD as of now, today, will be Azure Privilege Identity Management. So this is part of Microsoft Identity Governance. Okay. This we actually thought of doing it next week, but I'll just give you overview. And we will continue about this on next week. Okay. So with this, what you can do is, you can have, you know, who are the privileged users in any organization? If can someone tell me?
Global admin and
And so how do you manage? Yeah, CEO. So how do you manage access of these users? Okay, if their identity is compromised, right? So then you are in big trouble. If someone has your identity, you know, as a global administrator, you are in big trouble. Microsoft will reset the password for you, but it should not go, right? You have to manage it. So this is where Microsoft Identity, you know, Privilege Identity Management comes in picture. So what this does is, you know, this gives you access based on time. Okay. And based on time, just in time, whenever you need it, then only you are accessing. Okay, you are not given global administrator role for, you know, your lifelong time or till the time you are in, within the organization. No, you have to become eligible for that role. Once you are eligible, that role, you know, is given to you for 1 hour or 2 hours to do your work. So that is how the privilege identity management is managed. So using this service, you can carry out following activities. So you can provide just-in-time privilege access to Azure AD or Azure resources. Okay, you have a Windows administrator. Okay, your VM is in Windows. You do not want your Windows administrator to access it every time, right? You want them to give them only on certain times whenever they need to do certain administrative tasks. So what they will do, they will go and activate that role. Okay, they will request for that role. So once they request, they are given it for 2 hours, 3 hours based on the conditions what we have applied. Or else you can also have an approval workflow. Okay, let's say I am a system administrator. I want the, you know, VM contributor role for a certain VM. So I will request for it. So once I request, it will go to my manager for approval. Once I approve, then only I'll have. So this is how you manage. Okay, and you will know who is doing what will, you know, when you have given access to that. And this is time bound. Okay, you are given it only for certain time. Okay, for like 2 hours, 8 hours, 1 month, for a 1 year, you are given for time. And the approval, so, yeah,
the approval process that you're talking about. So what if it's someone from the leadership team, if have to,
yes,
or the, then the approval also will that not cause any issue
if you like want to
taking approval for a leadership person? Like they will have if they have multi-factor authentication, then they will probably able to do it, right? So
yeah,
approval is something here, yeah.
So what happens right now, this is for only privileged users I'm talking about. Okay, so the owner of the company will not use his global admin credentials every time, right? He will have altogether a different ID. He will be just using emails and all those things. But you as an IT manager, you as an IT head, you as an information security consultant, you as a database, you know, infrastructure head, you know, you are a privileged user for that organization. Okay. So what you will do, you will be the leader and you have your team under you, right? You will delegate your work to your subordinates, right? And for that work, you have to give them certain administrative rights to do that. Okay. Let's say I am working under you. I worked for you. We have, you know, sub-base Oxley compliance, right? Segregation of duties. I am allowed to work for 6 months only in one manager, under one manager. So at that time, you have to change my role every time. So what you do is it with privilege identity management, you give me the role only for 6 months. After 6 months, the role is gone. Even that 6 months, I am just eligible. I cannot have that role every time. Okay, when I, in that 6 months also, whenever I have to log in as a administrator, let's say security administrator, I have to activate that role. Okay, once it is activated only, then I will be able to do it. Okay, so enforce, you know, multi-factor authentication is enforced every time. Okay, and you are get notification when your privileged roles are activated. You can do that. And other thing, what you can do it for governance and audit purposes, you have access reviews. So you can review access quarterly. Why are you, you know, you can create a review, okay, and send a review to all the users, whoever are having the roles, admin roles, the privileged roles, and you can ask them whether they want that role or, you know, why are they using that role. Those kinds of reviews can be done with this, you know, product. And you have audit history also for both internal as well as external audit. If you are doing security audit, so the IT auditor will ask you all those things about, you know, who is having access, what level of access they've been having, all the privileged users, then you can use this service there. Okay. For this, you require P2 license. Okay. And you must be a global admin to work, you know, to use this. So whenever you take privilege identity management, you have to be a global administrator. Once you take in, you also become privilege identity administrator. Okay. So as I said, there are two role assignment type. One is eligible, another is active. What I mean by eligible is you as an individual are eligible to become security administrator, for example. Okay. but that role is not active for you every time. Okay, you have to go and activate that role whenever you have to use the role. The other is active role. You are always active as a global admin, which is not good thing to do. Okay, that is the reason we are taking primary, you know, privilege identity for just-in-time access. As I said, access reviews, you can do access reviews and you can see who is doing what, and you know, based on the review you can give them access, you can make them privilege identity, or you can remove them from the privilege identity. So we'll just do a small demo on that. I'll just go to privilege identity and you can see my roles as a user. What are my active roles? I can see I am the global administrator role, okay, and I am also the privileged role administrator because I have consent to the privileged identity, right? Now what I am doing is I am going ahead to Azure AD roles and I'm going to roles, okay, and I'm assigning a role. Let's say I'm assigning a security administrator role to user 5, okay, not bulk user 5, to normal user 5, okay. So now this user 5 is eligible for a security administrator role, okay. Now I go to settings. So he's eligible. Should I make him active? No, I will not make him active. If I make him active, he's always the security administrator. I just want him to be eligible. Should I make him permanently eligible? No. I want him to be eligible only for 1 year. The maximum you can make him eligible is for 1 year. But in our case, we will just do it for, you know, 1 day. Okay. So today is 5th. So we'll do. So he is eligible for 1 day. Now let me log into user. I have given user 4 also. So I'll just show this user. So I go to privilege identity. I go to my roles. Okay. And you see, he's eligible. His roles is not active. He's not a security administrator now. He cannot do anything which is related to security. So now he's go to eligible role and he'll activate. Okay. And he will say activate for how much time he wants. I say, you know, I want it for 2 hours. I'll say that why I need this. I'll say I need to pull out some security reports, okay, and I'll activate it. So now the role is getting activated, okay.
It is getting activated. I just want to understand here, it's like in this particular scenario what you're creating right now. So you're creating a privileged identity management for someone who is into higher management, right? So this will be still done by the global admin or the person who is assigned to it. Am I right?
See, higher management is not always a privileged user. Okay.
Uh-huh.
Because privileged users are the administrating users who make their hand dirty in terms of administration of the organization, in terms of IT. Okay. Let's say the CEO and the CFO, they are, you know, privileged people in the organization, but in terms of usage, they are not privileged. They just use email.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But as a information security officer, as a CTO or an information security consultant, or as a system manager, or as an IT manager, you are accessing the IT resources, right?
Exactly.
So you are the privileged user here.
Okay.
So I have to control your access. Okay. As a CTO of the organization, as a chief information security officer, I have to control your access because you are day in, day out using the IT resources. Okay.
Yeah.
Now you see the role is active. So now I can go and view all the security reports if I want to. Okay. I to go reports. You can see I have all the access to reports and everything. I can see audit. I can do anything. Okay. Previously I was not able to do that. So this is how you get the access for now. After 1 or 2 hours, the access is gone for this user. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So this is how the privilege identity works. So we are logged in as user 4. And other thing, what you can do is you can do access reviews, as I said, right? You can create an access review. You know, let's say the review name is for security admin. So you will start it one time, or you can do weekly, or you can do one time. I'll do just one time. Everyone, and I can, which role I want to do it. I will do it on security administrator. So now what happens, whoever, who will review this? I will review this as a CIO of the organization. I will review this. So whoever, all the members, you know, they will do self or selected self. If they want to do self, they can do, or, you know, selected user. I have selected myself because I don't want them to do self review. I have to do the review. Upon completion, what you have to do, enable them, you know, disable them. Want to make a change, you have to approve access, okay? And you create that. So this security administrator will receive an email, because this guy does not have an email associated now, so I cannot show you that. So this guy will receive an email stating that, you know, there is an access review, so you have to tell me why you need this access. So based on that, if he gives me appropriate answers to all the questions, which, you know, for giving all the required information for me to approve, as an, you know, CIO of the organization, I will approve the access again to him. So he'll still be the review. I can remove the access also. Okay. I hope it is clear till now. We have, you know, crossed the time, you know, what we have. So we have one more topic to, you know, cover, which is the Azure AD Sync. So I don't know if you guys are comfortable to stay for some time, or should we do this next week?
So we'll do it next week. Let us practice this one first.
Yeah. Okay. Sure. So we'll do it next week. So practice this a lot. You know, you create a lot of policies what you can do, but make sure you exclude yourself. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
And also, would you mind just sharing the information on the WhatsApp group, whatever is required, so that we can practice a little bit in this week time.
Yeah. You just get a, you know, as of now, for identity, for practicing the users groups and all those things, you need not require anything. You can just do it with your current account which you have created yesterday. But okay, if you want to practice conditional access, identity protection, and privilege identity management, then you need to have premium plan 2 license. So you can go and take the trial of premium plan 2.
Okay. I'll check out for that one.
Yeah. So this premium plan 2 license comes with Microsoft EMS. Okay. So you take the trial of Microsoft EMS E5. Okay. E5. Remember, I'll just SMS this. You take this trial of this E5. So you have try now, right? This option. You go and try it out. Make sure you sign up with the same account which you have created your Azure Active Directory. Sorry, your Azure trial account. Okay. Or else the other option, what you have, right? If you go to your portal and security, it will ask you to, you know, get the trial here only. So you can take it from here as well. Okay. So any other questions, guys? Or, you know, we can end this call.
So here there are in adding this privilege identity management. So one is the admin will give the permission to the user. So and another thing is user can also request the permission, right?
No, if they are eligible, then only they can do. Okay.
Oh, so first let admin has to make few users eligible.
They have to make them eligible.
Okay, then only they can request.
Yes.
Okay.
So usually, you know, let's say in organization, you will have that security team, right? So yes. based on your needs, they will make you eligible, or they'll give you rights. They'll make you eligible. Let's say you joined as an IT manager. So you should have access to the administrative parts of all the IT systems what you have. So by default, in the, you know, when you join, you'll speak with the IT team, you know, you will say, I need all these roles. So they'll make you eligible for all those roles. So once you're eligible, you can, you know, activate that role whenever you want. Okay.
Okay.
For what depends, you know, again, for every role, you can have approve also. So let's say if I go to Azure AD roles, okay, and I go to setting, and I am going, let's say you want a role of user administrator. Okay. So I go to user administrator. So you have settings here, right? So you can tell, you know, how much time, you know, this role can be active. By default, it will take 8 hours. You can say 4 hours only. Then you can say approval also. Who will be approval? Approval, you are just a user administrator. Approver will be manager. So manager, you can give the manager name here and he will select the approval. So whenever the user, anyone who is eligible for user administrator, he has to get, he has to, you know, go and activate that role. Once he clicks activate, the manager will receive an email asking for approval. Okay. Then manager will log into privilege identity management and he will approve it. Then only you will have access. So this is more higher level of security. Okay. If you do not check this, then he can just type, I want this, we can activate the role. So based on the roles you can do, let's say, usually people do it for a global administrator role. If someone is requiring global admin role, you have to go to all those, you know, approval process, and you can have more than one approval. Okay. That is done at the role level. If you go to setting and you go to global admin and you do that. Okay. So it is must, if you are asking for global administrator role, it is must you take approval. Okay.
Yes.
It's approval. So whoever is eligible for this role, right? Whoever is eligible for this role and how much time you want this assignment to be active. Okay. Allow permanent eligible? No. You want them to, you know, this role should be only given for 15 days. Okay. Not more than 15 days. Okay. And you say notification, it's much. You mention all those email IDs who we want to get notified. So what you will do in this case, this is global admin, right? So you will have the email ID of your CIO, CTO, and your CISO. You will have all those email IDs and you will, you know, go and assign it. And you update it. So whenever, if someone is asking for a global admin role, so first they have to get approved, okay? And that three people have to approve. And once it is approved also, everyone will get email notifications. So this is how you, you know, manage all the privilege identities. So this is a very good product from Microsoft. So any questions, you know, Adas?
One more question. So yeah. In the conditional access, like we said that we select the devices, right? Either Windows device or Android device or iOS. And yes. Apart from that, we are giving MFA and various other authorization things. So yes. Like if we given for a particular user that he should be logging using Windows device, so with MFA and all, so there is no way for him that he can log in through Mac or iOS something.
So right? If you are giving only, he cannot do. You cannot log in from Android or iOS device also.
Okay. It won't even ask for MFA.
No, he'll say that, you know, security administrator has restricted, you know, the access. It gives him a message.
Okay. Right.
You can try that out, you know, because the reason I did not, completely showed you all the things. I want you guys to, you know, practice it out. So once you do that, right, you create certain policies assigned to user and you assign that. You say that user should only log in from Windows and you try to log in from any Android device, you will not be able to log in. Okay. You create a user called, you know, Windows user domain name. You create a conditional access policy which says that this user should only access from Windows device, and for that users you apply that policy and try to log in from another device, from Mac or iOS or Android mobile, you will not be able to log in.
Okay.
You can try that out. And you can also do it from IP address. Take your public IP, create a trusted location, and if you go to some other place, try to log in from that place. You will not be able to log in.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, we are 21 minutes, more on the time.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We'll meet you next
problem.
Week. Thank you. Bye.
Definitely. Everyone take care. If you have queries, I guess the group is open. You can, raise your questions there. And whenever I will definitely answer the things there.
Okay. Thank you so much, Asif.
Thank you so much.
Have a nice week ahead.
Sure, sure. And take care, guys. Be safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Allah Hafiz. Assalamu alaikum.
Answer.